with the virtual Michael Buffer. That was so creepy. And then we also had David Diamante too.
So this is what happened, right? Michael Buffer was doing the ring walk virtually. It was all going okay. And then after Let's Get Ready to Rumble, when we got to the stage of introducing the fighters, the production didn't pipe it into the arena. So on TV, it was fine. You heard Michael Buffer actually intro the fighters. But in the arena, it was just quiet. So after 30 seconds, I just said, this is ridiculous. So I told David to get up, and he had to get into the ring, and then he announced it. So it worked in the arena, and it might have worked at home. I actually thought it was a bad idea. I just said we were just having a friendly joke with the zone. They actually quite liked it, but because it kind of worked in a weird way that on TV you heard Buffer, and in the arena you heard Diamante, but seamless it wasn't.
If the zone quite liked it, then they had bigger problems.
Yeah, I think it came across okay on TV, but for me...
It was creepy.
Yeah, you're quite creepy sometimes.
Eddie, Mark Castro, for pro debut.
Yeah.
Usually pro debut, there's not a soul in the arena.
Yeah.
He's co-main, didn't show no fear, went and got the knockout. What did you think of how he handled it?
I think it was a big occasion for him. I mean, I changed his position. He was going to be the first TV fight. And when he showed me his outfit, I said, I'm going to actually put you just before the main event. And I think nerves got the better of him in the opening round or two, to be honest with you. I mean, he's a very confident kid. He might not admit that, but he did, you know, he didn't look very composed in the first round or two. When he started to settle down, when he started to, you know, set his feet, he's very, very good. Very, very good. But there's a lot more to come from Mark Castro, and there's a lot more to come from all our kids. I think Raymond Ford is a fantastic young talent. I mean, you see the benefit of sparring with the guys like Teofimo Lopez and Shakur Stevenson, and Ammo Williams is so exciting. You know, he's very, very heavy-handed. So Mark Castro is going to be a big star. I mean, there's a lot of people say he looks like Elon Musk.
He does.
You know, and I saw that. Yeah, a young Elon Musk. So hopefully he ends up making the same kind of money.
How does he end up as a pro debut, co-main event? I mean, aside from the fact he did great on the fight, but...
I just think that, obviously, we were very challenged in this show financially with no gate, or not the kind of gate that you'd expect for a normal Canelo Alvarez fight. So, unfortunately, we didn't have the budget for, you know, a show at MGM that generates another, I don't know, $7 million on the gate. So... We saw Frank Sanchez and we saw some good fighters, and I just felt that if we're going to invest in these young kids, this is the kind of platform that you need to give them the opportunity to do something different on. So a lot of people put young fighters out early, like Elie said, with no one in the crowd. And I get a buzz out of watching a young man like that go out in front of 12,000 people. And like I said, I think he had jelly legs for the first round. So I wanted just to give him the chance and the platform that maybe others couldn't have got. And if we're going to build a star, that was the perfect way to get him off the starting line tonight.
Excuse me. Omar Perez Campos from Guadalajara. We know Canelo and Canelo team wants to fight in his city, but so big fights like Saunders or Golovkin are possible in Mexico or just in another country?
I think the only way that can happen is if there's investment from the government, because I don't believe the gate financially would generate the kind of money that you need to make a fight like that. So does that mean that maybe a smaller fight comes to Guadalajara, like a Yildirim fight or something, you know, in the interim? Again, my relationship with them has been quite brief, so I don't know the full mindset. But I do get the feeling that they would like to do something quickly in Guadalajara. And, you know, for me, that's the kind of thing that goes down in history. Now, when you talk about legacy, doing something in his home city would be amazing, would be incredibly special. So I think that that's really the next step for him is to take challenges, not just in the ring, but out of the ring. You know, and that would include Europe, or, you know, Tokyo, Guadalajara. So that's another question for him. You know, if he turned around to me and said, I'd like your help to do a show in Guadalajara, I mean, well, I'd go there tomorrow.
So in your ideal plan for Canelo, which fight do you want to make it happen first, the Billy Joe Saunders or the Golovkin fight?
I think the Golovkin fight is the bigger fight, globally, you know, bigger fight for DAZN. But, you know, at the same time, I want to give Billy Joe Saunders a big fight. You know, he had that fight. We agreed that fight with Golden Boy. He actually flew out to Las Vegas to get ready and start training, and we were one day away from the announcement of that fight. So it kind of feels like a little bit of unfinished business there. Again, I think that's, you know, money doesn't seem to be the single motivator for Canelo Alvarez. I think he wants to fight the champions, and, you know, but for me, the next fight in May anyway should be Billy Joe Saunders or Triple G. Anthony, do you have any updates?
I'll ask you if you would.
So there you have it. Another great video for ES News. For ESNewsReporting.com, I'm Elie Seckbach reporting. And you can follow me on Twitter at Seckbach. And you can follow me on Instagram at Elie Seckbach.